But the first thing I have to do is I have to make sure that Homeland Security that's filming this gets my face. I want to make sure that you remember my face and that you remember what I'm saying today. Because I'm going to talk about some of the things that all the politically correct people don't like me to talk about. I'm going to talk about our culture. I'm going to talk about the risk of losing our culture. You see, I'm not intimidated by the fact that compassionate people, like compassionate conservatives and liberals, want me to embrace everybody and consider every culture equal. I don't feel that way. I'm tired. A man walked up to me just today and said that in this very city where we're standing, people are now selling bread in the streets. And he asked a police officer, is that legal? Is that allowed? And he said, get used to it. Well, if I wanted to live in a third world country, I could move to one. I don't have to bring third world customs to America. I'm sick and tired of being told that there's a moral equivalency between countries that have fascistic, tyrannical rule and the United States of America. But we're about this close right now to going in that direction. And the subject of illegal immigration has always been near and dear to my heart. And I'll tell you why. I'm Hispanic, and I resent the fact that there are people who come to my country and refuse to learn to speak my language, refuse to adapt to the customs of this great nation, and also expect hardworking American citizens to stand down and stand aside so that they can take my jobs, they can live 31 to a house, and they can continue to flood my schools with children that they, by the way, they reproduce at a rate about three times what American citizens do. And that's not bigotry, and that's just fact. And I'm tired of teachers, and I've got friends in this audience today who are teachers who have been forced to take a training in learning how to teach classes to children who don't speak the English language. It's an outrage. When I came to the public school system in New York, I had been speaking Spanish in my home. And my mother sent me to school and said, go out there and learn this language and come back and teach it to me and my grandmother. She wanted to learn the language, and she was an American citizen because Puerto Rico is a commonwealth of this country. And she still knew that I couldn't do better if I didn't speak English. I could be on Spanish language radio or Spanish language television if that's what I wanted to do, but I'm an American citizen. I'll go to Puerto Rico or Cuba or somewhere else if I want to speak Spanish. I live in a land where English is the language, and I'm tired of being embarrassed about that. La Raza does not speak for me. La Raza doesn't speak to the other gentlemen and women here today who are Hispanic. They never did and they never will, because I'm an American. I just happen to have some Spanish heritage. I also have some Hungarian and Austrian heritage, and I don't expect the society to adapt to my Hungarian language either. There have been immigrant groups coming to this country since we began. And at all times was the expectation that they would learn the language, that they would be self-sufficient within a very brief period of time. And if they required sponsorship, it wasn't the city, it wasn't the state, and it wasn't the federal government that sponsored them. It was family members. It was members of the community who offered them a place to live, food to eat, and a job. There's no possible expectation on the part of anyone to come to this country and expect the American taxpayer to be responsible. This FAIR study that came out, I want you to think about this for a minute. How many of you are struggling, make decisions? I had a conversation this morning with a very upper middle class family member who said his family hasn't been on a vacation in years. They don't have enough money to take a vacation. How many of you know that $678 of your tax dollars in the state of Florida went to support illegal immigrants? That's an outrage. I'll take that $678 and I'll be as compassionate as I want. I'll give it to my church. I'll give it to charity. I'll support any kind of effort to be a decent American. But I refuse to reinforce illegal behavior. Frederica Wilson had the nerve to try and change our language again, to say that illegal immigrant or illegal alien was an inappropriate term. It's the only appropriate term to describe it. you've all heard the story. Calling an illegal alien an undocumented worker is like calling a drug dealer a pharmacist without a license. You have a right to be angry. You have a right to be armed with information, and that's the problem. We've dumbed down our children, and we've been dumbed down so much that they spend all of their time involved in this ridiculous reality television show. While they're watching reality TV, reality is setting in America. And reality is that you're losing every single day a little bit more of your country, of the very fabric of the life that you love. The idea that there are actually photographs and videotape being taken of American citizens standing on a corner in Jupiter, Florida, because they are considered to be a danger to this country is an outrage, and you should be outraged. I'm not the enemy. You're not the enemy. Don't let them tell you that you're the enemy. You're the only hope to save this country. Whether you stand here peacefully gathering, there's not a single person in this organization or any other organization that I deal with, from Tea Parties to Flyman to Enos and the Dade County Concerns. There's not a single person in any of those organizations that has hatred in their heart. What they have is love of country, love of humanity, and love of the rule of law. I love the idea that I live in a nation of laws, and I refuse to stand back as my laws and my cultures and my language and my borders disappear. The idea that we had to wait till the last day of Bush's presidency to see a pardon for Border Patrol agents who went to jail for doing their jobs. It's an outrage that Ramos and Pompeo spent a moment in jail, never mind years in jail in solitary confinement. This went on in our country because we stood down and we didn't stand up for them. Well, it's time to start standing up for the law enforcement officers. And believe me, these men and women who are taking photographs today and who are trying to worry about me, I'm their biggest supporter. I'm their greatest fan. I'm the person who tells you that they're the thin blue line and that will fundraise for them and speak at their gatherings and do anything, not the illegal immigrants that they're worried about. They don't care about police officers. In their countries, the police officer is a target. And in this country, law enforcement has been a target. All the shootings that took place in Broward County, 3/4 of the shootings against police officers in Broward County were done by illegal immigrants. 3/4 of them. Those officers didn't have to die, didn't have to be hurt. And that's the bottom line. The bottom line is, you have a right to defend your rights. Because if you don't, nobody else will. Margaret Mead said that never believe that a small group of concerned citizens can't change the world. It's the only thing that can. And you have to now make it your business every day, as Bill Landis and many of the other speakers said, to educate one person. You don't have to be aggressive. I mean, obviously, I'm aggressive. But somebody's got to do it. Somebody's got to do it. But you have to have a conversation. It just makes sense. You have to turn to somebody and say, with a 9.4% unemployment rate in the state of Florida, why would we allow any illegal immigrant to have a job? In a state where we are struggling, we can't balance the budget, they want to cut the schools which can barely educate the children while they accommodate the children of illegal immigrants, and while the hospitals accommodate them as a primary care center, you ask your neighbor, is that okay with you? Because every time I frame the question correctly, the answer is always the same. No, it's not okay with me, but what am I going to do? This is what you're going to do. You're going to gather. You're going to educate one more person. You're going to stop looking at party lines when you make a voting decision, because both parties are the same. It doesn't matter whether it's an R or a D. They love the power. They want to contain themselves. They want to stay in Washington. They want to stay in Tallahassee. They want to stay in the political system. It was never designed to be a career. You're supposed to go up there to serve like you serve in the military and then come back to your community. So what we've done with this two-party system is allow them to become career politicians. Therefore, they answer to nobody but their campaign contributors. And I don't know about the rest of you, but I stopped contributing a couple of years ago. So they're not answering to me, that's for sure. So what you have to do is look at individuals, look at candidates, look at what they stand for. Find out if they've got that fire in their belly. Because if they don't, they will be submissive when they get up there and nothing will change. You know, I stood up here and I laughed because I watched people react to Colonel Allen West, who is the first candidate I've ever endorsed in my career. And I watch people who react to that fire in his belly, his absolute integrity when it comes to telling the people who are already in power that their party is over if he gets to Washington. You need people like that to run for the mayor of Jupiter, to run for the commission seat in Pompano Beach, to run for any public office. Get your farm team raised up so that we can take Washington back. He can't do it alone. We're going to have to start putting together candidates. There's another candidate here that's going to speak to you. Check them out carefully. Make sure that what they say lines up. When Marco Rubio came on my show, I said to him, you stood in the way of six House bills about illegal immigration, and he said, it wasn't my priority. Well, guess what? If it wasn't his priority, I'm not sending him to Washington. And that's the way, and it's not because I don't think he could be a leader. I think he probably could be, if he spends enough time with me, he could probably be, you know, a better leader. But I'm not that interested in grooming candidates. But I will tell you this, it's time now, really, it's time now for you to make a decision that you're not going to stand down. If I've been called a racist, I've been called a Hispanophobe, I've been called... obviously, I'm now a radical extremist. I'm an anti... The newest memo out about me is that I'm anti-Islamic because I dare to stand up and say that there's no way I'm going to live in a country that's been radically Muslimized. It's not going to happen on my watch, and I'm not afraid to say it. I know who the enemy is. You're not the enemy. You're not the enemy. The enemy are terrorists. The enemy are people who want to change my way of life, and some of them may be your gardeners. And I'm not afraid to call it out. If there are people in this country who don't love this country and they don't belong in this country, the only words I have for them, goodbye. And that goes for Americans who hate this country. Keith Olbermann, goodbye. Janine Garofalo, goodbye. Susan Sarandon, goodbye. We don't need you here. So don't be afraid. Talk back, email, fax. You see these people who have organizations from Flyman to Concerned Citizens of Dade. You get involved with these people. You support their efforts. You, if you're going to make a contribution, make it to one of these organizations that have been out here defending you week after week, month after month, and getting the word out. That's where your money should be going, not to these lame brains in Washington who send you these solicitations and tell you how they're going to put a post office in your neighborhood. You know, I'll tell you something. We're not going to have post office soon, all right? So, you know, it's almost irrelevant, some of the solicitations I get from politicians. And you need to start paying careful attention to that. Support the people who have been fighting for you, who stand on the front lines. Show up at these rallies. Show up at the Tea Parties. Show up at a Million Man March on Washington. And take your country back. Because if you don't, he's absolutely right, Allen West. Someday, like Ronald Reagan said, we'll be trying to describe to our grandchildren what it was like to live in a country that was free. I don't want to be in that position. So I thank you very much for your time and for coming out today. Don't stand down. And buy your hat.